Hello, dear friends, and welcome once again to our Hilldale Video Bible Study. And as always, I'm just so grateful to have you join me and just continue to participate with me in the study of God's Word. Let me say that this recording is being made in advance as you are hearing me speak here, more than likely unless you hear me very, very late in the week. I will be in Anaheim, California, attending the Southern Baptist Convention. And let me just say that if you are listening to this sometime on Wednesday, let me just encourage you to just continue to pray for the remaining session that is taking place there, because as some of you may be aware, this has been a very difficult year for Southern Baptists, and there's a lot of decisions that need to be made, and we're just praying that God will receive glory and honor and praise for what he can do with our denomination. So I appreciate that so much, and I appreciate the fact that I'm getting to go with Brother Larry and Brother Paul as we go to the Southern Baptist Convention along with our wives to represent our church for the interests that will bring glory and honor and praise to the Lord Jesus. And in the meantime, let me say that once again, I'm glad that you're continuing to stay with us in our study of the book of 1 Kings. We are plowing right along here as we're continuing in this study. And this will be our third study, our third week in 1 Kings. And all this quarter, we're going to be looking at these two books in the Old Testament, 1 and 2 Kings. And let me say that there are a lot of amazing things that we're going to learn as we work our way through these books. So let me encourage you to stay with us. Sometimes people think, oh my goodness, studying all of those kings, that's probably going to be a little bit boring. Let me tell you, if that's what you think, if you will stick with me, you will realize that you have another thought coming for this, something that's very, very good. First of all, the kings themselves are not what you would call just extremely static and low profile and boring. These kings all have strange and different personalities, sometimes good solid characters for the Lord, at least in a few instances. But in many cases, these kings step away from God in some radical ways. But either way, we learn some valuable lessons. And also, we study the prophets, the miraculous earlier prophets, and not the least of which is Elijah and Elisha. These are amazing men of God, and they represent some of the greatest and mightiest works of God that we find in all the Bible. As a matter of fact, Elijah, I would almost describe him as downright scary to some extent. Fascinating study. We'll see more about all of this in the days and the weeks to come. So you stay with us as we study through 1 and 2 Kings. And in the meantime, let me encourage you to stay with us here at Hilldale Baptist Church. We have great summer activities, especially for the young people, as they will be involved in several of the camps, both youth camps and sports camps and other activities. And also, let me say that we're continuing with our pastor's Bible study on Wednesdays, and Brother Lindell continues with the music program. So good things are taking place here through the summer while God is giving us a little rest from the school year, but still good things taking place here at our church. So God bless you so much for being a part of our study today. And let me just invite you to just stay with me here over this next 45 minutes or so as we look in 1 Kings. We're going to be looking at 1 Kings chapter 11. So you might want to get your Bible and get ready to follow along with me as we go into that passage of Scripture. Pause with me, if you would, as we begin for a word of prayer. Oh God, we cannot thank you enough for how great you are and for the wonderful things that you do. Oh, Lord, you are gracious in a thousand ways. And oh, God, you are loving to us. You are merciful to us. And Father, that all of that, despite your great, infinite majesty and glory, oh, God, you did not have to create us at all. Father, you did not have to have anything to do with the physical universe. And certainly, oh God, you did not have to continue to tolerate mankind who has hurt you and disappointed you in so many ways. But oh God, you went the extreme length in order to deal with the ugliness of men. Oh God, thank you for sending Jesus Christ to die on the cross to save us from our sins. Oh Lord, we give praise and glory to your holy Son Jesus for all that he means to us. And oh Father, we pray that you just help us to always, forever, be giving you praise and honor and glory in your Son Jesus and just rejoicing in all that he has done. And Father, we also want to just lift up all of these dear friends who are continuing to stay with us. And Father, I thank you because the fact that we're able to study your word together. Lord, everyone who is watching this presentation now has concerns that they are wrestling with in their own hearts and lives. Father, I pray that you would just pour out your spirit upon them. Help them to feel your touch. Help them to feel your love right now as they are watching. And God, I pray that you just let your spirit be strong upon all of us. We need you. Lord, we need your love. We need your touch. We need your guidance. And God, we need your help. And oh, Father, we pray that you would just help us today as we seek to draw nearer and closer to you. Help us to repent of all sin. Help us to just turn to you with all of our hearts and lives. Help us to seek to draw near to you and love you with our hearts. Oh God, now as we look into your word, I just humbly pray, Father, you know that this word cannot be taught. It cannot be preached. It cannot be done by this feeble speaker, oh God. But Lord, you have the power to do all things. You let your spirit speak to our hearts and lives. Feed us, nourish our souls with the power of your word today. Help us to draw near to you and rejoice in all that you have done. And we will thank you for what you do. In the precious name of Jesus we pray. Amen. All right, let me ask you to take your Bible and turn to 1 Kings chapter 11. The title of our lesson today is Compromised. And this will be the last lesson we will have on King Solomon. And unfortunately, it will be a very sad lesson. The title Compromised means that Solomon compromised with God Almighty. And that's a very bad and dangerous thing to do. Solomon rebelled in his heart against the Lord. Maybe he wasn't claiming that he was rebelling or thinking that he was rebelling, but he definitely moved against the laws of God in a very serious way. He committed great idolatry. We'll say more about that in just a few moments. Our focal text is verses 1 through 13 of 1 Kings 11. Our background passage begins with chapter 9 and goes through the end of chapter 11. So we'll be talking about the content of those four chapters here in just a few minutes. But before we actually begin our Bible study, let me, as usual, go through several facts of background to help us to understand a little bit about what we're studying today. The very first part of 1 Kings is mostly about the reign of King Solomon. The first 11 chapters tell the story of how he ascended to the throne in the direction of his father David. And as it goes through that account, it continues to relate how Solomon received all of his great wisdom and wealth and about how he went about the building of the temple and various other projects, in particular his own palace. And he was blessed by God enormously through all of this. And people marveled. They were amazed at the great wisdom and the great prowess, the great organization, the great skill. The Queen of Sheba came to visit Solomon, and she said, "What I have seen has taken my breath away," as she saw the way that he performed all that he performed in such eloquence and majesty and beauty as he organized all of his administration for the kingdom. However, all of this section ends on a very different note. In the latter part of his life, Solomon sinned greatly. And it started with the fact that he married literally hundreds of wives. And these wives turned Solomon's heart toward false gods and the vile worship of pagan nations. And as a result, God brought great judgment upon Israel, and that judgment resulted in the splitting of Israel apart into two separate nations. Now, Solomon married many foreign women. And the reason that this started out, and it actually started early in his reign, he married Pharaoh's daughter real early. And the purpose for doing this is so that he could forge an alliance. And that was always considered a smart thing for a king to do from a worldly perspective, to marry the daughter of a foreign king, the king of another nation. That way there's an alliance is formed, and that generally certifies good relations between the two kingdoms when that kind of thing takes place. So it was recognized among the kings in ancient times to maintain peace and to maintain good trade relations. However, Deuteronomy chapter 7 verses 3 and 4 tell us that the law of Moses strictly forbade God's people for intermarrying with the women of other nations. And hey, that doesn't just include all of the common people, but it includes kings as well. Why? Because women who came from, or spouses who would come from other nations, would have the desire to worship their old pagan gods. And God wanted his people to be separate and apart. And the last thing God wanted his people to do was to break the first and second commandments of the Ten Commandments. You shall have no other gods before me, and you shall not make any graven or carved images. And that's exactly what these foreign peoples would want to do. And that's what began to happen to Solomon. And it led to his tragic downfall. Solomon eventually married 700 wives and 300 concubines. Now, these 700 wives were described probably as princesses of foreign nations, and probably it wasn't all 700 of these probably weren't from foreign nations, but probably a number of them were from many wealthy or noble families in Israel. But the point is, for heaven's sake, 700 women, and that's besides the 300 concubines. And these probably may have been women who were selected to form a harem for the king, but they were all considered his wives, 1,000 wives that Solomon had. And the practice of Solomon's marriage here to these hundreds of women demonstrates that no matter how close to God a man can get, and Solomon was very close to God in his early years, no matter how close to God a man can get, over time, he can grow proud, he can grow arrogant, he can grow self-confident, he can get full of himself, he can get arrogant and selfish, and he can get extremely far away from God over time. And let me say to you, it can lead to very tragic consequences. It's hard to understand how a man who had the great wisdom of Solomon could plunge to the depths of such depravity. That is a lesson that we all need to learn. No matter how wise or how intelligent or how brilliant or even how spiritual or how wonderfully close to God we can get, we can all fall and we can fall hard. So God help us, give us the grace to learn the tragic lesson of Solomon well. Now the latter part of chapter 11 tells of the enemies who rose against Solomon. The chapter names two enemies in particular, Hadad the Edomite and Razan the son of Eliada. Both of these men schemed to invade certain parts of the kingdom, but because of Solomon's great sin, God raised up one man that you could describe as an enemy who really did not intend to be an enemy, but God simply set him in the position of, if you would call him such, set him in the place of an enemy. This man's name was Jeroboam. Now, Jeroboam was one of Solomon's lead administrators. Man, he really did well with Solomon's work projects. But one day, while Jeroboam was walking along with a prophet of God by the name of Ahijah, Ahijah took a brand new cloak that he had been wearing, and he ripped this cloak into 12 pieces. And he gave 10 pieces to Jeroboam, and Ahijah told him, "You will become king over 10 of the 12 tribes of Israel. Solomon is going to lose the kingdom, but God's going to leave two tribes in the line of David in order to fulfill his promise to David, because God had promised that David would have a permanent reign over his people." Now, we will study how this was fulfilled and how it all took place next week. But in our background passage, we do read of this prophecy of Ahijah to Jeroboam. All right, well, continuing along as we share with you, the outline of Kings can be described in four parts. First of all, there's the reign of Solomon in chapters 1 through 12. And then it's 1 through 11. I think I have a misprint on my slide here. But it's 1 through 11, and then in chapters 12 through 16, we have the earlier kings of Israel and Judah. And then in chapters 17 through 19, we have the ministry of Elijah the prophet. And then finally, in chapters 20 through 22, we have the ministry of other prophets. All right, in last week's lesson, we talked about how that Solomon prayed and dedicated the temple to the Lord. This was before Solomon began to commit great sin. But we learned that as Solomon prayed, he says, when we learn we've sinned, we should cry out to God in repentance. We can seek God's forgiveness for all of our sins and transgressions in prayer, and God will not fail to make good his promises to us. Now, today's lesson, we will learn that we can slowly drift from God even if we have good intentions. And Solomon thought, well, it's okay if I marry these foreign princesses. And he had good intentions. He didn't intend to get away from God in the beginning. But he did wrong by disobeying the word of God and perhaps maybe never even thought about it. But the scripture says that he married these foreign women. And the Bible gives us the principle that association with evil people will often seduce us into sin. And one sin can lead to another and then another until we fall completely away from God. And that's what is going to happen to Solomon tonight. All right, the preceding passages in the background text include chapters 9 and 10. And in the first 9 verses of chapter 9, God told Solomon, he heard his prayer, blessed him with all of that. And then in the last part of chapter 9, it describes how Solomon built some store cities and all of that was fine. And he built a fleet of ships. Uh, and, uh, And Solomon did some other things, but we begin to pick up a sense as Solomon traded to King Hiram some cities that Hiram considered worthless. We began to get a sense that Solomon began to slip away in his dependence upon the Lord. Then in chapter 10, the Queen of Sheba visited Solomon, and we also read about how Solomon accumulated great, great wealth. All right, that concludes our background study. Now let's actually go into the focal text. The first section of our focal text is called Warning Ignored. It's verses 1 through 3 of chapter 11. So look at these verses with me, if you will. In 1 Kings chapter 11, beginning in verse 1, and we'll read through verse 3. It says, "Now King Solomon loved many foreign women, along with the daughter of Pharaoh, Moabite, Ammonite, Edomite, Sidonian, and Hittite women from the nations concerning which the Lord had said to the sons of Israel, 'You shall not associate with them, nor shall they associate with you, for they will surely turn your heart away after other gods, after their gods.' Solomon held fast to these in love. He had 700 wives, princesses, and 300 concubines, and his wives turned his heart away." All right, let's talk about these sad verses for a few moments. Coming back to verse 1, it says, King Solomon loved many foreign women, and along with the daughter of Pharaoh, and he named these five different nations, the Moabites, Ammonites, Edomites, Sidonians, and Hittites. Now, we read all the way back in chapter 3, verse 1, about how Solomon married Pharaoh's daughter. And again, the purpose for marrying these women of different nationalities was just a means of making good alliances. Now, Moab and Ammon and Edom, they were all nations that had some ancient, slightly related ties to Israel. For example, Moab and Ammon were both sons of Lot, and of course Lot was a nephew to Abraham. And Edom, that nation actually was a nation of descendants from Esau, who was Jacob's brother. However, Sidon and the Hittite Empire, Sidonites and Hittites, were both Canaanites. And of course, the scripture tells us that the Canaanites were people who were to be cursed and they were to be destroyed. And most of them were by Joshua and the new generation of Israelites who first invaded the promised land. They were really ugly, nasty, wicked people. They were just horribly immoral people, and they had committed atrocious crimes, really against mankind in all kinds of ways. They would sacrifice their babies in the fire. They would do all kinds of ugly things. So God had announced, he had proclaimed that these kingdoms would in fact be obliterated. That's what God intended for all these different nations. Now, Solomon disobeyed God's law because he not only engaged in association, but he literally married women from these nations. Now, in verse 2, notice it says that these were from the nations concerning which the Lord had said to sons of Israel, "You shall not associate with them, nor shall they associate with you. They will turn your heart away after their gods." Now, it says that Solomon held fast to these in love. Now, the author is actually quoting Deuteronomy chapter 7, verses 3 and 4. And that passage tells the Israelites they were not to associate with these foreign nations, not to marry their women. So Solomon had directly broken the law of Moses in enacting these marriages. And when it says he held fast to these in love, that means that he was just infatuated with these women in physical attraction. And so he just refused to give them up. Verse 3, it says he had 700 wives, princesses. Now, what that word princesses is there in the New American Standard Version is it's basically making it a positive, or in other words, it's simply giving you extra information about the wives. It's another noun referring to the wives. 700 wives or princesses. A lot of these wives were princesses or daughters of kings from other nations, and 300 concubines. And his wives turned his hearts away. Now, these wives were also called of noble birth in the NIV and in the New Living Translation, the New International Version, New Living Translation. And that indicates they were either daughters of kings or they were daughters of wealthy or noble families in Israel. But the author of Kings proceeds to show us how that the law of Deuteronomy 7 started its consequences. And now, how was that? Well, Deuteronomy 7 warned, these foreign people will turn your hearts into idolatry. These people will cause you to go after other gods, false gods. And that's exactly what happened with Solomon here. All right, that concludes our first section. Our second section is called A Divided Heart, 1 Kings chapter 11, verses 4 through 8. So begin reading with me, if you will, beginning in verse 4, and we'll read through verse 8 here as we continue. In verse 4, it says, for when Solomon was old, his wives turned his heart away after other gods, and his heart was not wholly devoted to the Lord his God, as the heart of David his father had been. For Solomon went after Ashtoreth, the goddess of the Sidonians, and after Milcom, the detestable idol of the Ammonites. Solomon did what was evil in the sight of the Lord and did not follow the Lord fully as David his father had done. Then Solomon built a high place for Chemosh, the detestable idol of Moab, on the mountain which is east of Jerusalem, and for Molech, the detestable idol of the sons of Ammon. Thus also he did for all his foreign wives who burned incense and sacrificed to their gods. All right, let's talk about these verses. In verse 4, it says, for when Solomon was old, his wives turned his heart away after other gods. So I think probably in his younger years, all through his younger years, he really, at least to some extent, truly devoted himself to the Lord God as his father David had done. But when he got old, maybe he became more mellowed out and he turned into an old man that was silly and vulnerable to the whims of his pagan wives, and they prevailed on him to commit these grave sins of idolatry. Either way, Solomon did not do as his father David had done. Now David committed terrible sin at one point in his life, but David repented of that sin. He cried out to God for forgiveness and God forgave him. And the scripture indicates that through the rest of his life, David completely sought the God. Now there was one or two times when David fell away from the Lord, but again, he came back and repented. David, even through his oldest years, clung to the Lord. And God promised David that he would always have a son to reign on the throne. However, God did not make that promise to Solomon. Solomon had not done as his father David had done, and he determined even as David had determined that he would serve God alone through his older years, Solomon did not. Now, I think God worked that around in that eventually the Lord Jesus Christ, of course, would be born, who would, in fact, be the heir of King David. And so God made his promise good to David. However, it was not for Solomon's sake. Now, in verse 5, it says, "For Solomon went after Ashtoreth, the goddess of the Sidonians, and after Milcom, the detestable idol of the Ammonites." Ashtoreth was also called Astarte. Now, this goddess Ashtoreth was, or Asherah, was what was described as the female consort of the god Baal. Typically, she was worshipped by erecting a carved pole. And this goddess was also worshipped as the queen of heaven. Excuse me. Jeremiah is still dealing. The scripture tells us in the book of Jeremiah, he's still dealing with the women who would bake their little cakes to worship the queen of heaven. It's still that same ugly goddess. And then Milcom of the Ammonites was also called Molech or Moloch in other countries. And we'll see how he comes back again in verse 7. But this god Milcom was a detestable god, often worshipped by sacrificing babies in a fire. Several of these gods were like that. Terrible, terrible worships. Terrible, awful cultic worship. Not only did Solomon's wives engage in this worship, but it says Solomon himself went after these gods. So in verse 6, it says, "Solomon did what was evil in the sight of the Lord and did not follow the Lord fully as David his father had done." So the author of Kings is clearly describing Solomon as having defected into the stance of evil in the sight of God. Now David had sinned wickedly before the Lord, but David had fully repented. And for the most part, he did seek God for the rest of his life. But Solomon, in his old age, he did fall away from God, and the Bible never says he ever repented. In verse 7, notice it says, "Solomon continued, he built a high place for Chemosh, this detestable idol of Moab." And then, and that was done on the mountain east of Jerusalem, probably on the Mount of Olives there, east of Jerusalem. And for Molech, the detestable idol of the sons of Ammon. Now these high places built for these two gods so close to Jerusalem, it demonstrated just how wicked Solomon finally acted in his old age, like some really stupid individual, some really foolish old man who fell away from God. How that could happen to a man who had once been as wise as he was is really hard to understand, but it's a strong lesson we need to learn. Verse 8 tells us, "Thus also he did for all of his foreign wives who burned incense and sacrificed to their gods." Now these two incidents in verse 7 were examples of what Solomon did for the many of his foreign wives, and he had so many of them, hundreds of them. And Solomon did this for many of these foreign wives. They were all worshiping their pagan gods. All right, that concludes our second section. Let's move on to the last section. It's called Discipline Promised. So read with me, if you will, verses 9 through 13 of 1 Kings chapter 11 as we move into the last section of our lesson. Beginning in verse 9, it says, "Now the Lord was angry with Solomon because his heart was turned away from the Lord, the God of Israel, who had appeared to him twice and had commanded him concerning this thing that he should not go after other gods. But he did not observe what the Lord had commanded. So the Lord said to Solomon, 'Behold,' he says, 'or because you have done this, and you have not kept my covenant and my statutes, which I commanded you, I will surely tear the kingdom from you and will give it to your servant. Nevertheless, I will not do it in your days for the sake of your father David, but I will tear it out of the hand of your son. However, I will not tear away all the kingdom, but I will give one tribe to your son for the sake of my servant David and for the sake of Jerusalem, which I have chosen." All right, let's talk about these verses. In verse 9, it says, "The Lord was angry with Solomon. His heart was turned away. Didn't matter that he was a foolish old man. Solomon knew better than to do all the things that he had done." So God was angry with him. God had appeared to Solomon twice. He appeared to him once in that dream when he told him he had given him anything that he wanted. And Solomon asked for wisdom. And it was a wonderful thing. God said, "I'll not only give you wisdom, but give you wealth and fame give you honor. And you'll be greater than any other king has ever been in all these different ways." But look at what Solomon had done. Again, God appeared to him in the dedication of the temple. The Bible describes in 1 Chronicles, or I should say 2 Chronicles chapter 6, how that fire fell from heaven and consumed the sacrifices during the time of the prayer of King Solomon and the dedication of the temple. It was a glorious thing. And all the people just worshiped and praised God. It was amazing and wonderful. And that night, God spoke to Solomon again, and he told him, he said, "I will answer your prayer if you will walk with me and abide with me." So God had appeared to Solomon twice. And now God was angry enough to pour out great and terrible consequences on Solomon. Verse 10, and it says, "And he had commanded him to do, concerning this thing, that he should not go after other gods, but he did not observe what the Lord had commanded." So in 1 Kings chapter 6, God had told Solomon he would bless him as long as he walked in his commandments. But then in verses 6 and 7, he warned, and this is chapter 9 of 1 Kings, he warned Solomon that if he fell away and began to worship other gods, that the kingdom would be taken away from him and his family. Now, despite this direct warning from God, Solomon committed grievous idolatry. In verse 11, "So the Lord said to Solomon, because you have done this and you have not kept my covenant and my statutes, which I commanded you, I will surely tear the kingdom from you and I will give it to your servant." And of course, God was referring to Jeroboam that I mentioned earlier. So God spoke to Solomon. He pronounced judgment against him, declaring that he would carry through with this penalty that Solomon had been warned about. Now, notice what he says in verses 12 and 13. In verse 12, he says, "Nevertheless, I will not do it in your days for the sake of your father David, but I will tear it out of the hand of your son." You say, well, why doesn't God go ahead and enact it during the time of Solomon? I mean, after all, Solomon is the one who sinned. Well, God had made a promise to David. In 2 Samuel chapter 7, verses 12 through 15, God promised he promised David that he would not take the kingdom away from either David or from his son in the way that he took it away from Saul. So God was going to keep his promise. He did not take away the kingdom from David. And because he had made that promise to David, he did not take the kingdom away from Solomon during his lifetime. He would not rip the kingdom from Solomon, but he would wait till after Solomon had died. All right, we look at verse 13, and there's one more thing that God was careful about. He says, "However, I will not tear away all the kingdom, but I will give one tribe to your son for the sake of my servant David and for the sake of Jerusalem, which I have chosen." Now, what this means is it means he says, "I'll not take the whole kingdom away, but I'll leave one tribe." Now, some of you may be saying, well, what about over there where it says that Ahijah ripped the cloak into 12 pieces, and he gave 2 pieces to Jeroboam and said, I'll give you 2 tribes. Here it says 1 tribe. Well, I think probably the understanding revolves around the fact that really there was one predominant tribe. Actually, there were 2 tribes that were given over to the hand of Solomon's son Rehoboam that Jeroboam did not take. These 2 tribes were the tribes of Judah and Benjamin. But Benjamin was a tiny little tribe that was actually enclosed by Judah all around. And if Benjamin, to some extent, was really swallowed up by the large tribe Judah. So practically speaking, it was really only 1 tribe, like it describes here in verse 13. So for even though it was 2 tribes, Judah and Benjamin, for practical purposes, it was 1 big tribe called Judah. So the northern kingdom became Israel and the southern kingdom became Judah. So God promised David he and his descendants would have this eternal kingdom. And so he would not take the entire kingdom away from the line of David. And of course, this one predominant tribe was David's own tribe, the tribe of Judah. All right, that concludes our focal text. Let's take a quick look at a few verses left in the background text. There in verses 14 through 43, it describes how God raised these adversaries against Solomon. And then also Ahijah promises that Jeroboam will receive the 10 tribes of Israel as a kingdom. So all of that is found in that last part of 1 Kings chapter 11. All right, that concludes our study for this week. Our lesson next week is called Divided. And it's 1 Kings chapter 12, verses 6 through 19. And let me say, this is what it's going to look like after the death of Solomon. And we'll see how Israel got split into 2 nations. One was called the northern tribe of Israel, and the other one, or the northern nation of Israel, the other one was called the southern nation or southern kingdom of Judah. And we'll see how it happened next week. And again, some strong lessons we can learn about what it means to do what's right and what's good in the sight of the Lord. So be sure and come back and join us in our study next week. And God willing, I will be back doing a live lesson in front of folks in the sanctuary next week. So let me ask you if you would to join me in a closing word of prayer. Father, thank you for the opportunity to study your word. Oh, Lord, help us to take these truths and apply them to our lives. Oh, God, you know what it is that we need to learn from all of these pages of Scripture. Teach us, oh, God, help us to take these truths and apply them to our lives. Keep us away from idolatry. And Lord, we know that idolatry is as real today as it was back then, even though it may not be little stone idols or statues sitting on our shelves. Lord, there are many things that we worship that are ungodly in your sight. Oh, Lord, we pray that you'd help us to draw near to you. Help us to love you with our hearts. Help us to walk with you and serve you. Keep everyone safe this week. Help us to take hold of you and just rejoice in all the good things you do. We thank you for what you'll do. It's all in the precious name of Jesus we pray. Amen. Thank you once more for sharing with us in the study of God's Word today, and we hope you'll be back with us again next week.